Hey there, it's Bee. Have you ever taken a moment to admire a large tree like this white oak? Oak trees are amazing organisms. White oaks can grow to be 90 feet tall and live to be hundreds of years old. These majestic trees are even more amazing when you consider where they come from. A single seed inside a tiny acorn. How? Where does all that extra mass come from? And not every oak seed housed inside a protective acorn ends up growing into an oak tree. Many are eaten by a variety of animals, including chipmunks, squirrels, and birds. To these species, acorns are an important source of energy. And of course, the oak tree itself needs energy to grow, produce leaves and acorns, and perform other life functions. But where does all this energy come from? To answer these questions, we need to learn more about one of the most amazing and important processes on Earth, photosynthesis. By the end of this lesson, you'll be able to identify the organisms that conduct photosynthesis, describe the reactions of photosynthesis, and explain the impacts of photosynthesis. We've already discussed that photosynthesis occurs in plants, but they are not alone. Two other categories of organisms perform photosynthesis as well. The first is algae. Some algae are single-celled and microscopic. Other algae are multicellular and visible to the naked eye. These macroscopic algae are often called seaweeds. Though seaweeds may look like plants, they are not. Plants and algae have many structural differences that set them apart. But like plants, both microscopic and macroscopic algae do perform photosynthesis. Also like plants, algae are made of eukaryotic cells and contain specialized organelles called chloroplasts where photosynthesis takes place. If we take a closer look at a chloroplast, we can see that it contains structures called thylakoids. The thylakoid membrane is a lipid bilayer, similar to those that make up cell membranes. Thylakoids in a chloroplast form stacks, as shown here. The region inside a chloroplast, but outside of the thylakoids, is called the stroma. As we'll see shortly, all parts of the chloroplast are important for photosynthesis. Chloroplasts are green because they contain the pigment chlorophyll, which absorbs light energy. Okay, so plants and algae contain chloroplasts and perform photosynthesis. But what about that third category of photosynthetic organisms? It is a special group of bacteria called cyanobacteria. Do you remember what type of cells bacteria are? They're prokaryotic. In fact, evidence suggests that today's chloroplasts originated from cyanobacteria, which entered eukaryotic cells more than a billion years ago, giving eukaryotic cells the power to photosynthesize. These lucky eukaryotic cells were the early ancestors of today's plants and algae. We'll begin by zooming into the leaf of a plant, where most of a plant's photosynthesis takes place, and focus on just one of the many chloroplasts in one of the leaf cells. Photosynthesis consists of two sets of reactions. First are the light-dependent reactions, which take place in the thylakoid membrane. These are followed by the light-independent reactions, which take place in the stroma. The process starts when a particle of light, called a photon, enters the leaf and is absorbed in a photosystem. Photosystems are combinations of proteins and chlorophyll pigment. When light is absorbed in the photosystem, an electron from a chlorophyll molecule is excited to a higher energy level. The excited electron, and the energy it contains, is transferred away from the photosystem by a series of molecules. This is called the electron transport chain. The electron that moves along the transport chain contains the energy originally absorbed from light. As the electron moves along, some of its energy is used to pump hydrogen ions from the stroma, the outer part of the chloroplast, into the thylakoid. Remember from the previous unit that energy is required to move substances against their concentration gradient, from low to high concentration, as happens here. Next, the electrons in the transport chain arrive at a second photosystem, which also contains chlorophyll and absorbs light energy. When light energy is absorbed in this photosystem, the electron becomes excited once again. The energized electron travels along another short segment of the electron transport chain before it arrives at a molecule called... Let's just abbreviate that as NADP+. NADP+ is capable of bonding to an additional hydrogen atom, but only when extra electrons are available. The electrons at the end of the transport chain are taken up by NADP+ molecules, which become NADPH. The NADPH reaction can go in reverse too and release electrons, which is important in a later stage of photosynthesis. So, the electrons that move along the transport chain are clearly important, but where do they keep coming from? Won't they eventually run out since they keep leaving the photosystem and moving to NADPH? Fortunately, a familiar molecule is available to save the day. Water. Plants absorb water through their roots, which moves up narrow xylem tubes to the leaves. Some of those water molecules end up inside thylakoids. During the light-dependent reactions, these lucky water molecules are broken apart into hydrogen and oxygen. This chemical reaction releases electrons, which replaces those removed from the photosystem and keeps the supply of electrons coming. Since the water molecules are split inside the thylakoid, they also help further build up the hydrogen concentration being created by the electron transport chain. And what happens to the oxygen atoms from water? They bond together to form O2, oxygen gas. The O2 is released from small pores on the plant's leaves called stomata. Don't confuse stomata with stroma, the outer part of the chloroplast. Remember that enzymes are proteins that help chemical reactions happen. As its name suggests, ATP synthase helps synthesize ATP. But what is ATP? It's the nickname for a molecule called adenosine triphosphate, which is an important energy currency in living things. You'll learn more about ATP and ATP synthase in the PDF for this lesson. All right, let's take inventory of the reactants and products during the light-dependent reactions. Light energy is required to power the process, and water is required so it can be split as a source of electrons. Through the electron transport chain and hydrogen gradient, the original energy absorbed is used to produce NADPH and ATP. These two products are used in the second stage of photosynthesis, the light-independent reactions. The second stage of photosynthesis is called the light-independent reactions because they do not directly depend on light like the first stage does. The light-independent reactions are also known as the Calvin cycle. These reactions take place in the stroma of the chloroplast, outside the thylakoid. Through several reaction steps involving enzymes and other molecules, the carbon atoms from multiple CO2 molecules are linked together, along with hydrogen and oxygen atoms to form glucose. The NADPH and ATP generated during the light-dependent reactions make these steps possible. NADPH gives up the extra electrons it acquired from the electron transport chain and turns back into NADP+. ATP releases energy as it splits back into ADP and a phosphate group. These donations allow the light-independent reactions to proceed. The NADP+ and ADP are then recycled back to the light-dependent reactions to be used again, like a battery that gets recharged. By the end of the entire photosynthesis process, light energy has been transformed into chemical potential energy in glucose. Overall, we can simplify photosynthesis as light energy, water, and carbon dioxide being used to produce oxygen gas and glucose. To balance this reaction, 6 molecules of water and carbon dioxide are needed to produce 1 glucose molecule and 6 oxygen gas waste molecules. But as we've seen, this process requires many steps. Also, plants produce way more than 1 glucose molecule at a time. These are just the reactants and products involved in producing a single molecule of glucose. Okay, so plants, as well as algae and cyanobacteria, can transform light energy into chemical potential energy in glucose. But we're not plants. Does photosynthesis even affect us? Yes, it absolutely does. It's hard to overstate the importance of photosynthesis. We, and almost every other organism on Earth, would not exist without it. The glucose produced during photosynthesis, as well as the starch that plants form by linking glucose rings together, serve as the foundation for Earth's food webs. The life processes of both plants and animals are powered by energy that originally came from the sun. And it's not just carbohydrates. Plants can use the glucose produced through photosynthesis in further reactions to produce other molecules they need, including lipids and amino acids to build proteins. The plant uses these molecules to build its tissues, as do the animals who consume them. But our dependence on photosynthesis is not limited to energy in food. Photosynthetic organisms release oxygen gas into the atmosphere, which most organisms need to breathe in to survive, including us. And though plants release lots of oxygen, it's estimated that 50 to 80% of all the oxygen gas in our atmosphere is produced by photosynthetic algae and bacteria in the ocean. Without photosynthesis happening on land and in the water, we would run out of oxygen to breathe. In fact, the fossil record suggests that photosynthesis produced Earth's first oxygen-rich atmosphere billions of years ago. Before photosynthesis began on Earth, complex organisms like plants and animals could not evolve due to lack of oxygen. But when the first photosynthesizers, ancient cyanobacteria, appeared on the scene, they filled the atmosphere with oxygen gas, allowing more complex, oxygen-breathing species to develop. In addition to releasing oxygen, photosynthetic organisms absorb carbon dioxide, using the carbon atoms to form glucose. As we discussed in previous lessons, carbon dioxide is a greenhouse gas that plays an important role in our climate. Therefore, plants and other photosynthetic organisms that remove CO2 from the atmosphere are key to keeping our climate stable. Preserving and restoring ecosystems with high rates of photosynthesis, including forests, grasslands, and seagrass meadows, is essential to addressing climate change. Approximately 50% of a tree's weight is from carbon atoms. All that carbon was previously carbon dioxide taken in by the tree for photosynthesis. Animals, including us, contain large amounts of carbon as well. Our carbon also originated as carbon dioxide, was absorbed by a photosynthetic organism and got transformed into glucose and other molecules. Eventually, it made its way into us through food. You may not be able to photosynthesize, but the carbon atoms in your body have been through photosynthesis before. Likely many times. Okay, photosynthesis transforms light energy into stored energy in sugar. But how do the photosynthetic organisms that made the sugars and the animals who eat them actually utilize those sugars for energy? That requires another set of chemical reactions, which we'll learn about in the next lesson. Until then, remember, biology is more than just science, it's the way of life. Hey, hey.